The Jerry Powell Podcast is brought to you by Archstone Foundation. Archstone Foundation, improving the health and well-being of older Californians and their caregivers.
And supported by listeners like you, many of whom have donated on the Jerry Powell fundraising site, which you can find at www.jerrypowell.org, big blue button, or through reviews, stars on your favorite podcasting app. Big thank you. Welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast. This is Eric Wadera.
This is Alex Smith.
And Alex, we're going to be talking about poems today, right?
We are talking poetry, which I'm delighted about. I've been after Eric to do this podcast for years.
I've kept on been saying no.
And he has held the line. He has finally relented. So we are delighted today to welcome Marilyn McEntyre, who's a longtime teacher of literature and medical humanities. She has written a number of books, including one that's probably most relevant to today. I think it's titled Patient Poet's Illness. Is that right, Marilyn?
Patient Poet's Illness from Inside Out.
Illness from Inside Out. She also teaches people who are interested in writing their own books, and she's a poet herself. She's authored an essay, I think, titled Why Read a Poem at a Time Like This? And we'll try to include links to that in our show notes available with this podcast. Marilyn, welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast.
Thank you. What a pleasure to be here.
We also have Guy Micco, or Miko, depending on whether you want to pronounce. You're in Italy or in America.
And we are.
We are. Who is a longtime teacher in the Joint Medical Program, now emeritus. Joint Medical Program is between UC Berkeley and UCSF. I was a medical student there some 25 years ago or so, and learned at the feet of Guy classes such as death, aging, suffering, poetry. Those were great days. And he is no longer growing old. He had a birthday this week. He's also a part-time hospice and palliative care clinician, and he's had a long-time interest in medical humanities. He's one of my favorite teachers. Welcome back to the Jerry Powell Podcast, Guy.
Thank you. Thank you, Alex and Eric. Good to be here.
And Guy, since you have been a longstanding mentor for Alex and teacher, I think you are going to supersede Alex here and actually do this a song for us. What song are you going to play?
So this is a song called Hello In There by John Prine. It was released on his first album in 1971. I think he was about 25 at that time. But I've been told that he wrote this as a teenager, which is pretty incredible. We had an apartment in the city. Me and Loretta liked living there. Well, it's been years since the kids have grown a life of their own, left us alone. John and Linda live in Omaha, and Joe somewhere on the road. We lost Davy in the Korean War, and I still don't know what for. Don't matter anymore. You know that old trees just grow older, and old rivers grow wilder every day. Lonesome, waiting for someone to say hello in there. Hello.
That's great.
That was absolutely wonderful, Guy.
Well, thank you, but I missed. I blew one line, one word. I'll fix it next time.
Keeps it real. Thank you, Guy.
Yeah, I love that song.
Love it too.
So, why do you love it so much?
Well, Well, first off, John Prine loved it too. He played it, I think, every time he had a concert. And he just died a couple years ago of COVID, sadly, at 73 or something. He's my age. First off, I'm amazed that a young man could put himself into the place of an old man in such a poignant way. I mean, it's, you can just see his story unfolding in a way that makes you realize John Prine knew something about aging. He used to deliver papers, I read, in a nursing facility, and he would talk with people there as he delivered the paper on the paper route, and they'd sometimes think he was their son or a relative, and they'd have conversations. So he got some exposure, but he's just an amazing songwriter to be able to do something like that. And I personally like it because, well, it reminds me of a time when I was a young physician, like you two, and could have used this song in my mind when I went into nursing homes to care for people, and I saw them lined up in their wheelchairs along the corridors. And too many nursing homes are still like this. Many are changing, but people would be lined up, sitting and often strapped into their wheelchair, head bowed, not talking. Just a terrible scene. No one around. And, you know, I'm reminded of Bill Thomas's Eden Alternative, the three plagues, the three plagues of nursing homes, boredom, helplessness, and loneliness. Nursing homes, places where people are over-medicated and under-treated for these three plagues, all of which are treatable.
Likely have gotten a lot worse in the last 2 years, especially with COVID restrictions. Yes.
We could unpack that song for the next hour, but we do need to move on to topic of today.
Poetry and aging.
Yeah, poetry and aging. Eric, you want to ask the first question here?
Yeah, my question is, I'm going to go to Marilyn first. Have you always been interested in poetry, like since a kid? Like how, tell me how you got interested in it or when?
Well, I lived in a three-generation family, and my grandmother was an English teacher, and my mother was the teacher, and everybody read. And so poetry was just part of the family discourse, you know, people would come up with lines from things. And I loved that. It felt as though there was this big trove of words that we could pull up when we needed them, like having a big bowl of candy in the middle of the table. So I learned to love it very early.
How about in particular around this theme of aging in poetry?
I think I'm trying to think about when I first connected them, but years ago, when I started to be interested in medical humanities, medicine was always a road not taken for me. When I was younger, I really felt as though one of the things I might want to do is be a doctor. And for various reasons, I didn't do that. And so I was really happy when I found a way to come into medicine through the back door. And I do think that writing isn't always, but it can be a healing art, and that poetry has helped in the process of both psychological and even sometimes physical healing. I was teaching T.S. Eliot's Four Quartets at Mills College 1 year, and I started a class in poetry by just asking this big group of young women, why read a poem at a time like this, which is a question I like to pose myself and others. Then immediately a hand went up in the back, and this woman who was probably around 23 said, poetry saved my life. And she was dead serious about that and went on to talk about that. But I think I have had many real world encounters with people who feel like that, that there's a particular passage from a poem or a particular image or way of putting something that has given them a way of imagining their way back into health or sanity or peace. Mm-hmm. So I think it's pretty powerful.
How about you, Guy?
You know, I'm more prosaic in answer than Marilyn's lovely understanding of poetry. I probably came to it because in my youth, because I liked the kind of poetry that's sort of smarty pants poetry, like candy is dandy, but liquor is quicker. Yeah. That kind of poetry, Ogden Nash and limericks and the like. And then there was probably, I don't know, a few poems that just hit me, which I think is the particular ability that poetry has that transcends, in a way, prose. I mean, there are prose pieces that are like poetry, prose poems that are, where you suddenly have an insight that knocks you over a little bit. Doesn't have to be a great, you know, a lightning strike, but something that makes you go, oh, wow, mm-hmm. Yeah, I get it. I yeah. see an opening of some sort that you don't get in daily life. It's just a punch of sorts. I'm sure there are other words for that Marilyn can describe, but yeah, for and then in medicine, it opens up what I imagine could be called the empathic imagination. Like, you know, you get to see what it's like to be someone else, in the case of medicine, someone else who's suffering, in a way that transcends the biological, you know, our mm-hmm. biopathology is the forte of medicine. And I'm reminded of Eric Cassell, who mm-hmm. I don't know, you may remember, he died recently. He was mm-hmm. a bioethicist, internist, I think at NYU. Alex, you probably know.
I think it was either Columbia or Cornell, but
somewhere
in New York.
Maybe Cornell. And he said one time, look, when there's a problem with your heart, you don't get to just take it to the heart mechanic and leave it off and go away. Unfortunately, he said, there's a person attached to the heart. And as a physician, it's incumbent upon you to understand that. That's not just the heart yeah. that's got a bad rhythm or mm-hmm. was infarcted. There's a person with all the, you know, the other bio, but psychosocial, spiritual part of themselves mm-hmm. to work with. So poetry can open that up mm-hmm. for one. And, you know, John Prine's song is poetry.
Yeah, sure
that,
is.
That does. That's yeah. exactly what that does.
We want to get to the poetry here, and we'd love to hear a poem. Before that, I just want to read something that Marilyn, you wrote. This is about what poetry does. Poetry stops us short. It recalls us to contemplation in a world of action. Unlike narrative, which moves us through time and plot, poetry makes us pause, look again, go back and reconsider what we thought we saw or knew the first time. I love that. That was in an essay that Steve McPhee wrote about his experiences with patients and reading poetry to patients, which maybe we'll talk more about later and see, for example, whether Guy, you've done that. Marilyn or Guy, do you want to please read us a poem?
Go, Marilyn.
Well, I was going to start with Shakespeare's Sonnet 73, which most people know. But actually, when you asked about why poetry, and I was thinking about how certain lines come back to you, a line came back to me. And I thought I would read you just a little part of Robert Frost's well-known poem, After Apple Picking, because the whole poem is really about picking apples in the fall in New England. But it's also about many other things. And here are the lines that have come to me when I think about these transitions into the next season of life. He's talking about the load on load of apples coming in. And these lines are, for I have had too much of apple picking. I am overtired of the great harvest I myself desired. There were 10,000 fruit to touch, cherish in hand, lift down, and not let fall. For all that struck the earth, no matter if not bruised or spiked with stubble, went surely to the cider apple heap, as of no worth. One can see what will trouble this sleep of mine, whatever sleep it is. And then the poem goes on from there, but I wanted to mention it because that line, I am overtired of the great harvest I myself desired, so precisely talks about a moment when you think, I'm done. I'm done with that season. I'm done with this work. I'm done with this thing that I've done with so much energy for so many years. And now I need a new thing. And my favorite line is, there were 10,000 fruit to touch, cherish in hand, lift down and not let fall. And I thought about all of the students that have gone through my office hours for decades and trying to cherish each one of them, not let them fall, foster and mentor them and move them on. Mm-hmm. But there's a time when you reclaim something of your life and you leave a lot of that ministering to other people. And so I think that moment of transition is just beautifully captured in that poem. Mm. What I wanted to say about the sonnet, Shakespeare's Sonnet 73, it's short. I can read it or I can just say
please do.
Okay, I will read it. Sonnets are 14 lines. They're not that long. Notice as we read it that it's, the first four lines offer one image of aging. The next four lines offer a different image. The next four lines offer a different image. And then he closes with a couplet. Mm-hmm. That time of year thou mayest in me behold, when yellow leaves, or none, or few, do hang upon those boughs which shake against the cold, bare ruined choirs, where late the sweet birds sang. In me thou seest the twilight of such day as after sunset fadeth in the west, which by and by black night doth take away, death's second self that seals up all in rest. In me thou seest the glowing of such fire that on the ashes of his youth doth lie, as the deathbed whereon it must expire, consumed with that which it was nourished by. This thou perceivest, which makes thy love more strong to love that well, which thou must leave ere long. And so all it is really is a little reflection on, this is what he's speaking clearly to a younger person. This is what it is to be entering the last season of life. And one line I love in here is that you may behold that time of year in me when yellow leaves, or none, or few, do hang. Mm. And it isn't, the logic is yellow leaves or few or none, right? But to go or none, or maybe there are a few left, you know? There mm-hmm. might be some leaves left. We're not sure.
Yeah.
So there's a little flickering of humor or even pleasure in this poem that's very sober about aging. Yeah. And that makes me think of a lovely essay by the poet Howard Nemiroff on the similarity between poems and jokes. Mm. He says that a good poem always has something akin to a punchline where it surprises you into reframing something and seeing it in a new way. But even just what this poem does in trying out three different images of age is an invitation to say, play with this. You know, what is old age like? Mm-hmm. Is it like a river that's dwindling to a stream, or is it like a tornado that's coming down the path, or, you know, just trying out images for that can get at different dimensions of the experience. And that's what I love about this poem and so many others.
Thank you. Yeah. You know, personal reflections as you were reading the Robert Frost poem, I was thinking about, boy, you know, the so many patients I've seen, you know, hundreds, thousands, like apples, you know, from a tree. Mm-hmm. And you can just, you know, think about them as this, you know, often in medicine these days, we're come to think of our work, for some people, as a conveyor belt, of just, you know, one after another. But then when you think about each one and their individual selves, and how, you know, some are bruised, some are broken, and what we do with them and how we can take the time to cherish each one and for what it is. Mm-hmm. And I love the image of uncertainty there with the, some with yellow leaves, some with none, and the work that we've done in thinking about prognosis and how uncertain that is, even for older adults, though we make great efforts to try and quantify it.
We heard a little bit of potentially like what makes a good poem. What makes a good poem for you?
Well, I think it's that punch that Marilyn spoke of, that maybe I spoke of it too, a little insight that happens, and it's such a short period of time, such a short read often. I just learned in Italian there are two words you can use for poetry, poesia and poema. A poema is long, like Dante's Divine Comedy. It's a long, long piece. But poesia is short, shorter version, like Shakespeare's sonnet or Hello in There. And on reading it, you know, there are two, I don't know, Marilyn's so much more adept at this than I am, but on reading poetry, for me, occasionally I'll get it. You know, on first reading, it's just like, wow, there it is. I see, I understand. And, you know, maybe it doesn't, I can't say it changes my life, but it gives me a little view that maybe will last into another encounter with another person, perhaps, or just an understanding myself. And sometimes the other kind of poem is one that is, at least at first, barely scrutable, like T.S. Eliot's Quartets. I mean, you know, you got to study it, I think, and really dig and take some close reading to come to some better understanding. And then there's some that are just obscurant. It's just obscurantism to the max that I can't stand it. I think you asked Eric or maybe Alex it before we started about a poem that we didn't like. That would be the obscure poetry of, say, John, forgive me, Marilyn, you know, one of the greatest American poets who died recently.
Who was that?
John Ashbery.
John Ashbery.
I just don't understand any of his poetry. I don't get it. And I'm not, I don't have the patience to dig, I guess, or I would need help. On the other hand, Rilke is sometimes difficult, but I find it worth digging to come to an understanding of what he's trying to tell us. And often it's really worthwhile, but I don't get it right away necessarily.
Well, when we think about kind of the favorite aging theme poems, what came to mind? And can you give us an example?
Oh, yeah.
Read it for us.
Currently, my favorite is a little frivolous. I like humor in poetry. It doesn't have to be there, and often it isn't. But I'm going to read to you. I'll try to read it relatively quickly, and you can make it available to people. It's called Jane, by a fine poet by the name of George Bilger, or Bilger. I'm not sure how you pronounce his name. Jane, the old woman across the street, is lugging big black trash bags to the curb. It's snowing hard, and the bags are turning white, gradually disappearing in the storm. Jane is getting ready to put her house on the market and move into a home of some sort, a facility. She's just too old to keep the place going anymore. And as we chat about this on the sidewalk, I'm thinking, I'm so glad this isn't going to happen to me. It seems like a terrible fate to drag out your trash bags and then head for a facility somewhere. And all the worse to be old in a facility. But then, that's the whole reason you go there in the first place. But the great thing about being me, I'm thinking, as I continue my morning walk around the block, is that I'm not going to a facility of any sort. That's for the other people. I intend to go on pretty much as always I have, enjoying life, taking my morning walk, then coffee, then the newspaper, music, and a good book, Europe, vaguely, in the summers. Then another year just like this one, and on, ad infinitum. Why change this? I have no intention of doing so. What Jane is doing, growing old, taking out her ominous black trash bags to vanish terribly in the snow, getting ready for someone to drive her to the facility, that may be her idea of the future, which I totally respect, but it certainly isn't mine. Okay. Mm-hmm. So this is for us. This is for the people like us who think the people we're caring for don't have anything to do with us. It's like they're sick, they're old. I'm not. I mean, we don't even consciously think I'm not. We just act like it. And Bilger is making it explicit. I really love it. I use this. I hate to say I use poetry, Marilyn, forgive me, utilitarian view here of a poem, but I like to read this in nursing facility with the administrators, which I've done a couple times.
Oh. And what is their reaction?
And see how they react. Well, there's silence.
Yeah.
Or maybe a nod, like, oh, all right. Yeah. So that's the first poem that actually came to mind when asked about poetry and aging, even though it isn't necessarily the best, you know, it still is powerful.
Mm-hmm. Marilyn, when you think about, I'm going to read another piece from your essay. I think this is from your essay titled What Poetry Does. This is Steve McPhee incorporated a number of these quotes into his essay, which he read at a memorial service. This is second quote. Poetry trains us in a metaphorical habit of mind so that a world of flat surfaces becomes charged with meaning. It what seems discrete may be perceived as connected. And that speaks to me about the ways in which poetry connects you like a key going into a lock, and it just sort of fits in there, and it unlocks something which might have been inaccessible to you. And whether that's emotions that, you know, many of us in the health professions have packed away, whether that's ability to relate to our patients and their experiences, moving beyond, as in Guy's poem, the othering of the person. They're going to the facility, but not me. The way it makes three-dimensional surfaces out of two-dimensional surfaces. I like that expression. So I want to tutor you, Marilyn, see if you have any reflections there, and then if you have another poem for us.
Well, I think that there's a difference between what does a poem say and what does it do. And what does it do is a much more interesting question. Mm. And beyond that, what I have learned to ask in classes and conversations about poetry is, what does this poem invite you to do? Any good poem, even a long one like the Iliad, is going to invite you to stop. So it seems to me that there's always an undertow in a good poem. And even as you move forward, what you see will connect with something you just heard. Repetition is one of the basic poetic devices. And each time you see the word or the image again, it has a kind of, it acquires the density that makes it more interesting. And I think a good poem can invite you to think in phrases rather than sentences, especially contemporary poetry, where a lot of younger students don't get immediately why a poet would end the line right in the middle of a sentence. But there's a tension between a phrase and a sentence. Sentences do something all by themselves. And there's a chemistry of words sitting next to each other on the line where you get an effect before you get a whole statement. And so I think poetry gets us to that level of language that is, at its deepest level, is a kind of melody. We communicate at the level of musical exchange. We communicate by tonality. And so I think poetry really helps us to be attentive to language in its subtler dimensions. Mm-hmm. And I love that. And sometimes there's an exercise I would recommend to anybody, which is take three sentences you've written that you like and just lay them out on the page like a poem. Cut the lines where you want, make stanza breaks, and see what happens. Something will happen to them. It might not be a great poem, but something interesting is going to happen. And I'm going to give you this really quick example because I tried it with the JMP students a few times, the medical program. I said, write three sentences about an encounter with a patient. The first sentence needs to be, I didn't know what to say. Add a couple of sentences. So they did that. And then I said, okay, lay them out like a poem. Just make them look like a poem. Do anything you want. Here's what was interesting. this is really true. I had them all put their little poems on the board, and one person wrote, "I didn't know what to say," as the whole first line of the poem. One person broke the line at, "I didn't know what." And another person broke the line after, "I didn't know." And another person broke the first line after, "I didn't." Mm. Each one of those was a very different point of departure for entering into the rest of the thought of the poem. So I think poems are inherently playful, even poems about, even laments, even elegies. There's a playfulness about poetry that seems to me to be its spiritual dimension, which is, I mean, I really think a mark of the spirit, however you think of that, is a kind of playfulness that just says, like improv theater, yeah, okay, let's play with that. Let's go there. Mm-hmm. Let's imagine it this way. Yeah. So I can't remember the rest of your question.
Oh, do you have another poem for us?
Yeah. I had two more, but I think we don't have time for both. So I'm going to read you one called Long Life by Elaine Feinstein. Late summer, sunshine, the eucalyptus tree. It is a fortune beyond any deserving to be still here with no more than everyday worries, placidly arranging lines of poetry. I consider a stick of cinnamon bound in raffia, finches in the grass, and a stubby bush, which this year mothered a lemon. These days, I speak less of death than the mysteries of survival. I am no longer lonely, not yet frail, and after surgery, recognize each breath as a miracle. My generation may not be nimble, but forgive us, we'd like to hold on, stubbornly content, even while aging. One of my favorite phrases in that poem is stubbornly content.
Yeah.
That's what I plan to be.
I got a question for you, Marilyn. So doing with JMP students, and how important do you think poetry is for the medical profession?
Well, I think the easiest answer to why read a poem in a place like this, which I talked about that at the medical program one time, is that if you really practice, if you have a practice of poetry, just like if you have a practice of meditation, it can make you more attentive to words. It makes you a better listener. And I believe, and I've heard doctors talk about this, that you begin to listen for how people put things and for the metaphors that a patient will reach for to describe what they are experiencing. And for the patterns of repetition and for the pleasure they take in retelling their story and how they put it together. So all of that, the language dimension of clinical work is, it seems to me, very much more fine-tuned or refined. It's more of a precision instrument. Your ear is a better instrument if you listen for how and not just what.
We should have a cadre of poet physicians. In fact, they all should. All physicians should be poets. In fact, all politicians should be poets. In fact, who shouldn't be a poet? I mean, who couldn't learn from the poet's sensibilities?
Guy, Steve McPhee would read poetry with patients, and that's what this essay is about that I was excerpting Marilyn's quotes from. Have you ever done that?
Rarely. I've thought about it many times. I've thought, you know, Steve can do it. Steve had a very special ability in that.
And we should say Steve McPhee was a professor, is an emeritus professor at UCSF, internal medicine, wrote a textbook, and among many other things, helped start the comfort care suites at UCSF, and also read poetry to patients. So, Guy, go on.
Well, I think it's risky. It's it can be presumptuous to pull out a poem and say, I mean, I'm not saying Steve would do it this way for sure, but I have the for me, the vision of, well, here's a poem, you know, this is going to do us good. Yeah. I just haven't found that the opportunity where it's really appropriate, that I felt appropriate to me, except on a rare occasion, not in the hospital when someone is sick, like I think Steve has done, but in a clinic situation with, in fact, a couple of elder patients of mine who actually brought me the poems. And one was Sonnet 73, and she just loved this poem and wanted to share it. Another was sent to me when I was very sick in the hospital by a patient of mine. In any other setting, you might call it a little drippy, a Mary Oliver poem. Occasionally, Mary Oliver is too Mary Oliver-y for me. but you know, it's that, tell me, what will you do with this one wild and one wild, wonderful life of yours? On a summer day, I think it's called, the poem. And so in the proper place, at proper time, I think it's really wonderful to be able to share poetry. But again, it's really tricky.
Yeah. I haven't either. I have played music for patients or with patients, but I have not yet tried the poetry. We're running out of time here. We have 6 minutes left. Guy, do you have another poem that you could read to us before we get a little more John Prine?
This is called Sam at 60 by Pat Schneider. Do you know this, Marilyn?
Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder what you think of it. Well, anyway. He opens the front door with the force of a minor hurricane, the great bulk of him led by his belly, which is held in only metaphorically by wide red suspenders. His face is bushy with beard. He feels like a warm version of the north wind, all blow, hair going white, beard wild with curl. His cap is blue with a protruding bill and white letters proclaiming, "Friends don't let friends drive Fords." "Hello," he yells, the last syllable lifting into a question. Under the red suspenders, an orange tomcat grimaces on his t-shirt above the words, "Gimme coffee, nobody gets hurt." He brings what I've lost, Ozark country humor, sausage and milk gravy, biscuits, cornbread, lightning bugs at dusk, a million grasshoppers at noon. He has left his truck's motor running, parked as far onto my lawn as the oak tree will allow. "Had a delivery in North Adams," he says, planting a wet mustache kiss on my mouth. "Got any coffee?" "It's a busy day. I have plans, but I would make a pot of coffee for my brother if the world were coming to an end, because the world we knew together is coming to an end, and he's the only one who remembers the day I roller skated too far down the hill, how I fell, how he picked me up and called me by my childhood name." Really sweet.
I guess, Guy, out of all the poems that, you know, kind of go through your, why'd you pick that one to decide to
Here? I don't know. It's the sweetness of it, the humor.
Yeah.
I don't know. It just came to mind as one poem that I enjoyed in the past. I used this poem in Reader's Theater with students and elders. I don't know if Alex, you ever
talked about
prose. So we go to a nursing facility and read with students and elders together, and we'd split poetry or prose or whatever into parts for people to read together. And this was one that I thought was particularly effective with students and elders reading up, you know, one part each, dividing it up in various certain ways.
Guy, there's still a little of that kid in you. You said at the beginning who liked those, you know, zinger poems like "Candy is dandy, liquor is quicker." Friends don't let friends drive Fords. "Bring me coffee, nobody gets hurt."
Yeah, I would also be mindful of the time because I do want to hear some John Prine. But I agree with Alex. I want to thank both of you. It makes me think maybe I should branch out from my Shel Silverstein Running Babbitt book to maybe some of this. I see a thumbs up. But before we end, let's hear a little bit more John Prine from Guy.
Okay. don't talk much more. She sits and stares through the back door screen. And all the news just repeats itself like some forgotten dream that we both seen. Someday I'll go and call up Rudy. We work together in the factory. But what could I say if he asks what's new? Nothing. What's with you? Nothing much to do. You know that old trees just grow stronger, and old rivers grow wilder every day. Old people, they just grow lonesome, waiting for someone to say hello in there, hello. So if you're walking down the street sometime and spot some hollow ancient eyes, please don't just pass them by and stare as if you didn't care. Say hello in there, hello.
Guy, Marilyn, very big thank you for joining us for this podcast. You. That was absolutely lovely. And Guy, wonderful rendition.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.
And as always, thank you, Archstone Foundation, for your continued support and to all of our listeners. We'd also like to acknowledge the generous support for our Jerry Pal listeners who've donated over $250 each to support the Jerry Pal podcast,
including Meg Walhagen, Thomas Quinn, Rochelle Bernacki, Louise Aronson, James Tulski, Arden O'Donnell, Mike Steinman, Mary Ann Forcia, Ashok Krishnaswamy, Nancy Lunderberg, Gail Cooney, David Schiffeling, Cheryl Phillips, and Jessica Eng. Thank you very much.